Good morning, all the listeners and participants to this seminar today. Our topic is on South Sudan. I'm going to start by first of all looking at briefly the events that led to the conflict that we are seeing, or rather we are talking about today, and which led to the signing of the compromised peace agreement in August 2015. My presentation outline, I will start with a brief background on the compromised peace agreement, what it is, how it came about, and then pick up from there, looking at the post-signing events and the implications, and then the worsening humanitarian situation and the possible way forward. When we talk of what's happening today in South Sudan, the conflict, where it has come from and where it is today, and the events that have so far transpired, it's very, very important to look at why the compromised peace agreement, first of all, was reached and what it entails today. Why was it, first of all, reached? We know of the events that took place from 15th of December 2013, when Riek Machar, the then vice president, broke ranks with President Salva Kiir. And when that happened, when the violence took place, we saw the factions within the military, SPLM, or rather SPLA, which is the army wing of the ruling party, breaking up into two factions, pro-president faction and pro-vice president faction. And that is the genesis of the conflict that led to the signing of the compromised peace agreement, which I refer to in brief as CPA. Now, the CPA was signed with the two issues in mind, to end the conflict and to transform transit the country into a more stable and peaceful society. So in terms of, first of all, ending the conflict, it was agreed that within the next 90 days after the signing of the agreement, the government of national unity was to be formed. And that meant that Riek Machar would travel to Juba before, or by that time, by the end of the 90 days, to take up his rightful position in the transitional government, and with the president, President Salva Kiir, form government of national unity. If you are counting from August, of course, we look at it in terms of Riek Machar, the chairman of the armed opposition, signing on the 17th of August, and Riek Machar signing on the 26th of August. Sorry, on the slide it shows 27th, but it should be 26th of August, with the reservations. From that moment, if you count from 27th of August or end of August, 90 days from then, we are looking at around December, when the 90 days lapse, and therefore the government of national unity the transitional government of national unity should be taking over as from December. And yet today we do not see any signs of that happening, looking at the events that are taking place, what's happening, still a few reservations having been put into the agreement that Salva Kiir, the president, signed on 26th of August. We've seen a few happenings that do not really augur well for the country. With that, we saw the signing of the agreement by the president having been followed by threats of sanctions from the UN and the US and even regional countries, really putting a lot of pressure on President Salva Kiir to sign. And the 15 days that he gave were really used by the stakeholders, the international community, positively in exerting pressure to Salva Kiir in order for him to sign the peace agreement. And then we see him signing. Now, after signing, or rather just before the 17th of August, the day before the parties were to convene in Addis Ababa, Salva Kiir sacked or dismissed four governors, governors of four states, Western Equatoria State, Warrap State, Central Equatoria State, and Upper Nile State. By acting in that manner, a day before the expected signing of the peace agreement in Addis Ababa, we see already a contravention of the spirit of peace building within the country. Here is a plan to be signing a compromised peace agreement, but the day before that, you are sacking governors and then immediately appointing others. And besides that, the government of Jongole and the government of Lake State had been sacked some 700 days before August, when he was sacking this other, or rather dismissing the four other governors. But the governor of Jongole and Lake State, according to the constitution, the president, yes, has the power to dismiss a governor, but he should name new governors within at least a reasonable period of time, which is about 60 days. But now we are seeing over 700 days passing without naming the replacements of those states as governors. Now, that, because governors are electable positions, in according to the Constitution of South Sudan, the transitional constitution, it therefore means that the president, in a way, violates the law in terms of the appointment of governors, dismissal, and appointment. So we already saw signs of resistance in terms of the president taking positive steps towards peaceful resolution of the conflict. Now, a slight look at the post-signing event and their implications. I think it's always very important to start with the positive aspects of anything, even though negative sometimes overwhelm the positive. Now, we see that besides the controversial signing of the comprehensive peace agreement by the two parties, we've seen a show of positives, both internally and internationally from the stakeholders. For instance, on the 9th of October, the UN Security Council adopted the Resolution 2241, which extended the presence of the UN mission in South Sudan by 2 months. In this case, it goes up to mid-December 2015. And we see that being a very positive move because it coincides more or less with the time that the government of national unity should be taking over the reins in South Sudan, with the Salva Kiir, the president, and Riek Machar, his incoming vice president in the transitional government, moving into Juba and taking up their rightful positions and running the country. Therefore, I think this resolution is very timely. And the good thing with it is that it comes with an element of pressure or sanctions, especially for individuals or entities that threaten the peace, security, or stability of South Sudan. Those individuals could be sanctioned, targeted sanctions such as travel ban, asset freeze, and even in terms of their movement and actions being monitored with regard to the implementation of the agreement would be monitored very carefully. And as we all know, we have the panel of experts, pursuant to Resolution 2206 of March 2015, who are monitoring the violation of sanctions within South Sudan. Now, luckily, again, Article 2 of Resolution 2241 urges all parties to engage in an open and fully inclusive national dialogue, seeking to implement lasting peace, reconciliation, good governance. I think that's a very positive move with respect to the two parties coming together to form government of national unity in a transitional form. And then another positive event, or rather declaration, is by the Republic of Uganda, which on 10th of October declared its readiness to withdraw the UPDF, the Ugandan Intervention Force in South Sudan. I think that's a very positive move in terms of solidifying or rather consolidating the goods that the compromise peace agreement brings forth. However, we see the SPLA, the Sudanese People's Liberation Army, asking the UPDF to extend its stay in South Sudan. And that, I think, is a worrying aspect of the whole process, because that simply means that as long as the foreign forces that have intervened in that conflict are not withdrawing, it will be very difficult for reconciliation to take place, for structures of peace building to take place, for confidence building to start taking place in the hearts of Sudanese, especially the two sides, because within the 90 days since the signing, we should be having the transitional government of national unity taking over. And yet, if you are going to extend the stay of UPDF in Uganda, in Sudan, South Sudan, then it simply means that you are eating into that time frame. And therefore, that is not a very positive move by the SPLA. Now, let's look at what has happened so far with regard to those aspects. The UPDF, according to SPLA spokesperson, Colonel Philip Aguer, he tries to justify the need for the UPDF staying longer in South Sudan on the basis that the UPDF should continue maintaining the security within Juba specifically, because that means that it will allow the South Sudanese government, the SPLA specifically, to put in place the requisite security measures before the UPDF withdraws. But again, SPLA lays the blame in the hands of the SPLM in opposition, the Sudanese armed faction, for not signing the minutes of the security meetings they have been having in Addis Ababa. And those minutes, one of the clauses that is controversial and to which SPLM is basing its lack of or failure to sign the so-called security minutes is on the basis that one of the articles in those minutes calls upon the retention of a sizable number of SPLA forces within Juba. And as we know, the spirit of the Compromise Peace Agreement talks of demilitarizing Juba. And therefore, if that is the approach to demilitarize Juba, it would mean that UPDF should leave the Ugandan Intervention Force, and that the SPLM in opposition and the SPLA should form a joint security arrangement that would take care of Juba, and through that confidence will be built. But the moment SPLA is agitating for the retention of thousands of SPLA within Juba, with the exception of SPLM in opposition, then we already find that the aspect of peace building and confidence mechanisms being watered down. And therefore, we are at a state where the two parties, SPLM in opposition and SPLA, not really agreeing on the way forward with regard to the security of Juba. And that is the basis of SPLA urging UPDF to stay a bit longer as those aspects are being ironed out. Now, in a similar manner, this SPLM in opposition spokesperson, James Gadet, that is very much positive on behalf of the SPLM in opposition with regard to the pronouncements by UPDF to withdraw. So we are seeing the SPLM in opposition, the armed wing, being much more positive about the withdrawal of the UPDF as opposed to the SPLA, the government itself. Now, that again brings one will call friction between the two parties. If we go further and look at the negative developments, having started with the positive developments, the negative developments we see are that even after President Salva Kiir signed, with a lot of reservations, the compromise peace agreement on this 26th of August, we see a month later, slightly over a month later, on the 2nd of October, Kiir unilaterally announcing the creation of 18 new states. And that clearly is in violation of Article 161, Part 1 of the 2011 Transitional Constitution, which states clearly that the territory of South Sudan is composed of 10 states governed on the basis of decentralization. And therefore, by unilaterally announcing the creation of 18 states, an element that had been introduced in the negotiations by the SPLM in opposition and to which the SPLM, the government side of the negotiation, totally rejected, being brought in later by the president in a decree, although the SPLM in opposition was agitating for 21 states and all that, we see the president coming in later on his own to declare 18 states. That violates the constitution, which talks of 10 states. Besides that, it also waters down the compromise peace agreement, of which during the negotiations, the issue of creation of new states was dropped. So being introduced later, it simply violates the faith that the other party or and the other parties, because we have the civil society, we have the religious stakeholders who also are stakeholders in this whole process of peace building in South Sudan. Now, another negative development comes on the 17th of October, when the president dissolved the SPLM leadership structures, with the exception of his own position as the chair. However, this being an internal arrangement of SPLM, one cannot really go scratching hard at it, but we only need to question, or rather analyze, the spirit with which the head of state would nullify the structures of a ruling movement at a time when the country is focusing more on peace building. So that again becomes a challenge to the spirit of implementing the compromise peace agreement. Now, it shouldn't go without also focusing on Salva Kiir, Riek Machar, the incoming vice president in this joint arrangement, who maintains his position in Addis Ababa and does not seem to be looking positively in terms of the internal actions in South Sudan, with regard to showing signs of taking up his position within the 90-day time frame within which the transitional government of national unity is to be formed. I think it would show goodwill for him to be much more closer to the happenings in South Sudan, to engage much more closely with the presidents in Juba than criticize from the outside all through. It will not just be that one day he wakes up and flies into Juba to take up his position. It's a process. It's a process that brings together the diplomatic aspects, the political aspects, the civil society, and also further negotiations with the government in place in Juba today. And as so long as the two parties each maintain their positions, it's going to be increasingly challenging for them to really build towards a joint government of national unity that we are looking at. Because if we recall, looking back again at the compromise peace agreement, it talks of the first 90 days within which the transitional government of national unity is to be formed, of which we expect it to happen in December if we were to strictly maintain the time frame. And then from December, January 2016, give it 30 months. The Constitution talks of 30 months of transitional government of national unity, within which elections should be held 60 days before the expiry of those 30 months, meaning early 2018, we should be having elections. In essence, the Compromise Peace Agreement is a transitional document to maintain peace in the country until real elections take place in 2018. And during these 30 months, this instrument is supposed to be integrated into the transitional national constitution of 2011 and a new constitution or a revised form of the constitution within those 30 days to be ready to be used in the forthcoming elections in 2018. But if we see as things stand today, the party is still pulling and pushing. Internally, the SPLM not being as organized and many changes taking place, governors being reshuffled, and also on the side of the SPLM in opposition, we see them maintaining their defense positions in Upper Nile, in Unity State especially, then everybody would be very pessimistic looking at those aspects, that the country remains militarized. Time is drawing closer to 2018, the 30 months that you are looking at, of which if you subtract 60 days, then you have less than 30 months when you need to put all the building blocks in place as annexed on the Compromise Peace Agreement. The annex gives a calendar of events that should be happening. And if you look at that calendar, almost up to now where we are, many things have not been implemented. Then it portrays a very pessimistic picture. Unless the parties to the conflict, the signatories to the agreement, take it upon themselves to immediately speed up the process. Now, we cannot talk about the political dimension of the conflict without looking at the humanitarian situation in the country. Personally, I just came from South Sudan on a trip that took me to Upper Nile. I was in Maban. In Maban, you find the refugees from Blue Nile, the Sudan side, interlinking with the locals in South Sudan. And I was also in Unity State. I went to the protection of civilian site in Bentiu, and there I toured the IDP site and talked to the management, the camp managers, and all witnessed some of the horrific occurrences there, the daily burying of the dead, and it's all horrific, I would say. That if you imagine the catastrophe that the civilians are facing vis-a-vis the delays and the maneuvering politically, then it really calls for seriousness in terms of the parties to re-engage with the benefit of the common man at heart. For instance, the protection of civilian sites that I visited, specifically in Unity State, you find the youth are highly militarized. Actually, the camp, the IDP camp, which is holding about 150,000 individuals, is militarized in that the civilians are part of the conflict, moving in and out with weapons, at night gunshots here and there. And that particular campsite of the IDP is surrounded by government soldiers who are on prowl to try and control what's happening in the IDP side. We've had cases where government soldiers have shot live ammunition into the campsite. We've had youth robbing people within the campsite, the IDP camp, at night. The vulnerable civilians, fellow civilians, at gunpoint, you know, hunger, death. You witness a lot of these atrocities every day within the camps. And we've seen donors, some of them expressing willingness to withdraw from supporting a country that seems not to be showing seriousness with the implementation of the peace agreement that has been agreed on. And therefore, we are seeing the international community, especially the donor community, losing faith in the mechanisms that are in place, that are expected to be helping the country come out of the conflict, not showing those signs. And I think that is a threat to the whole peace process, because it would simply mean that the humanitarian situation, the humanitarian support that the country has been drawing from these international partners is going to run down, and the fatigue will come in, and the country may be left at a worse situation than where it has come from. Now, we could also look at the regional perspective to the conflict. We've had the IGAD peace process being very much behind the success we see today in terms of the compromise peace agreement. But then, if you look at these countries, then the so-called, or what we could refer to as the front runners in the region, we look at countries like Uganda. Uganda has played an active role in the conflict, not only in terms of military intervention, but also in terms of hosting even the displaced, just like Kenya has done with the many refugees being hosted in refugee camps in Kenya. Now, Uganda today is faced with a, of course, positively democratic change of government next year with the upcoming elections, or democratic elections for that matter. And therefore, President Yoweri Museveni is much more concerned, I would say, with the internal affairs of Uganda today than he was perhaps a year or two ago, because of the upcoming elections. Any other president would do the same in any case. So we might see that the withdrawal of UPDF being more of internal policy related as opposed to Uganda looking outside. In Kenya, we see Kenya also having its own issues. The ICC matters are on the highest level in terms of the ruling regime today. And therefore, it would be more of less external intervention than internal issues in that particular format. Looking at Burundi, part of the East African community, of course, to which other countries belong to, even if it may not be part of the parties that are actively engaged in South Sudan, but then it has an implication, because the ongoing simmering conflict in Burundi again calls on the regional countries to act. Tanzania, which played host to much of the negotiations again that led to the compromise peace agreement, is also having elections in October, later in this month. And therefore, South Sudan becomes of a lesser urgency, naturally, to Tanzania as well. So if you look at the region generally, Rwanda the same, which of course has also an interest in what's happening in the region, and therefore in South Sudan, Rwanda is having elections as well, not so long from next year. And therefore, we are looking at a situation where these countries are more concerned with internal issues as opposed to their own. Hence, we might see lesser and lesser attention on South Sudan. And therefore, with the parties the way they are, we might see a collapsing of this compromise peace agreement if the parties themselves do not realize that they need to drive the process forward. Now, the need of immediate, one would ask, why, what should happen? What would happen? I think in my own opinion, there's need for immediate international pressure on the parties, just like that kind of pressure led to the signing of the agreement by the two parties. The threat especially to their travel, to the freezing of their assets, any other mechanism, diplomatic or, and otherwise, that can make the parties commit themselves to the implementation of the agreement would actually be in the right direction. Otherwise, South Sudan, left as it is today, is likely to degenerate again into conflict or into a standstill. Now, for those who are able to see the PowerPoint presentation I'm doing, there is a picture of the protection of the civilian site, the IDP camp in Bentiu, in Unity State. A photo I took from an aerial view from a helicopter. And as you can see, the camera could not even capture the entire camp because it's so vast. And on the right side of the photo, you see pretty well organized kind of structures with the roads crisscrossing. At the far end on the left is the old side of the camp. And on the right is the new site, which thanks to the UNHCR and its partners, they've been able to organize the camp a little bit. And this has reduced deaths, especially linked to communicable diseases due to bad hygiene and all that, like diarrhea and cholera and the rest. But then we still have many IDPs living in the old site that you see at the far left of the photo. And this camp, this IDP site is hosting about 150 to 160,000 refugees in the middle of nowhere. And this camp is heavily militarized as well, because the guns thrive on the displaced fellow IDPs at night. There's a lot of violations of human rights. Rape cases are very common, and the deaths are being recorded in the range of 20s per day, people dying, especially children. So it's actually a very serious, a catastrophic humanitarian situation. There, that photo shows the burial site. This is a new burial site that has been opened after the other one got full. And what you see filled with water are open graves waiting for new arrivals. And that is the burial team. And with the rains now coming into the region, El Nino being talked about, when you speak to the burial team, they tell you the difficulty of even getting the body buried into the soil, because you see those graves are filled with water. They have to draw the water, bury, and every day between 10 to 20 bodies. And it's really a pathetic situation, very inhuman, that one would not hesitate to call on any party that would impress upon the parties in South Sudan to really fulfill the requirements of the compromise peace agreement, lead the country to 2018 successful elections, deliver the peace that Southern Sudanese so much need, and let those people who are herded together in IDP camps, let them go back home and resume their dignity and dignify their lifestyle. Up to that level, I think I beg to stop, and I thank all of you for having listened.